So in terms of the UK's involvement in the war in Yemen, the majority of it is through UK support for the Saudi-led coalition that's intervening. Now that, the relationship with, it's primarily with Saudi Arabia, it's also with United Arab Emirates and the other states in the coalition, but primarily Saudi Arabia, which as we saw in the film, there was that talk of the Al-Yamamah deal, which was signed in the 1980s and has been updated in the 2000s. Now what's quite important about that deal is that's a government-to-government deal. That's an agreement between the governments of the two countries and in, for the UK to provide military support and training and weapons to the Saudi military. That British support is then contracted out to a private company, to BAE Systems. So officially a private company operating on behalf of the British government. And that setup is mutually very convenient because the government gets to say that, well, we can't comment because it's a commercial matter. We don't have full visibility of the contractor's footprint. That's the language they use. We don't know what they're doing. They're a private company. The company, on the other hand, says, well, it's a government contract. We abide by the rules that the government set for us, so you better ask them. So there's this, it's the two sides of the same coin, right? And it's mutual deniability for both of them. That is the setup in which the UK is supplying fighter jets, bombs, missiles to the Saudi-led coalition for the war in Yemen that is causing what aid agencies, I'm never quite sure how you decide which is the worst, but it's like the world's worst humanitarian crisis, right? There's a cholera epidemic, Yemen is on the brink, if not in a situation of famine. It really is one of the world's worst humanitarian catastrophes as a direct result of the war. So the UK is also providing humanitarian aid and is very proud of its humanitarian aid. And DFID has been a major promoter of humanitarian aid. But what never gets discussed is the way in which the UK is also facilitating the war that is creating the humanitarian crisis to which it is responding. Okay, and that's, those things go together. Because one of the arguments in favour of arms exports is that they bring us leverage. There's this terrible war going on, and we didn't start it, and we're intervening, and we're trying to rein them in, and we're trying to push them towards a peace process. It's very complicated, don't you know, because there's lots of tribes, and then there's lots of kind of softly, sometimes not so softly, racist tropes about the Arab world, right? The argument goes, well, we sell, in selling weapons, that brings us leverage. But what we've seen recently with the attack on the port of Hodeida is the British government saying very clearly to aid agencies, we tried to exercise leverage over the United Arab Emirates to get them not to undertake an invasion of Hodeida, and we failed, so you will need to evacuate. Well, I'm sorry, you can't have it both ways, is my view, right? You can't say, well, we need to keep selling the weapons because that's what gives us diplomatic leverage, that's what allows us to push them towards a peace process, and then say, except we failed in terms of getting humanitarian provisions in this particular part of the war. So there's some interesting combinations of how those things go together. The last thing I want to say briefly is about the ways in which the government justifies its policy. If you look, any newspaper report that you look at where the government is asked, is criticised for its arms export policy, you will say pretty much exactly the same phrase. The UK operates one of the most robust arms export control regimes in the world. That's pretty much verbatim, right? It's either robust, sometimes rigorous, usually robust. Okay. Because one of the things that I think is quite important, especially for audiences like you, is there are sometimes we think, well, the government must just be ignoring its commitments. But what's quite interesting about this, about arms export policy in general, it's not that the UK is just ignoring its commitments. There's lots of process, right? They look at the license applications, they think about whether there's a risk, and they say, yes, there's a risk, but it's not clear. Because we don't definitely know whether the Saudis are going to use these weapons in international humanitarian law violations, in spite of all the evidence that's mounting up. So there's something weird happening within government, whereby they are paying attention to these things, but every single time they are deciding in favour of arms exports. Right? You heard Claire Short say about Tony Blair. Mm-hmm. Okay? There's something similar going on, but there is a lot of process around this. And one of what it allows the government to do is to simultaneously export weapons and facilitate war and claim to be concerned about international humanitarian law and human rights. And that's one of the things that marks out the British government as distinctive, right? because there is this kind of peculiarly British moralising about foreign policy that I think is quite particular. And I think that those two sides of the same coin, the selling weapons and giving humanitarian aid, selling weapons and claiming to care about humanitarian law and human rights, I think those things have to be understood in combination. Mm-hmm.